Hello everyone, this is International Grandmaster Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslikechess.com, and today I would like to introduce to you one of my favorite games of Garry Kasparov. This game was played back to 1981 between Garry Kasparov, who played white, and Ulf Andersson, another strong grandmaster. And this game was started with the following moves: d4, knight f6, c4, e6, knight f3, and b6. Playing b6, black enters the queen's Indian defense. He wants to bring the light square bishop to the long diagonal to take better control over the middle of the board, and specifically to take better control over the e4 square. It would be great for white to bring another pawn to the middle, playing e2, e4. But with the bishop on b7, it can be a harder thing to implement. And in the game, Kasparov played a3. The idea behind this move is to prepare knight c3, avoiding bishop b4. So white does not want black to pin the c3 knight when it goes out. And white is ready to spend time on this side move, just to be sure that he can, in the future, be able to play e4. Black played bishop b7, and after knight c3, Andersson continued with knight e4. In my opinion, not the best move for black in this position. He brings the knight to the middle, he tries to trade the knights, and if white does not take, black can consider to play f5, supporting the knight with the pawn. Knight takes on e4, I think the best move for white, otherwise, as I just said, f5 will be played, and black has more options in the case of knight takes on e4. He can use the pawn to take back. Bishop takes on e4 and knight d2. Kasparov plays very vigorously. He immediately attacks the bishop. And now black should decide what he is going to do with the bishop. If black moves it back, white plays e4. So white takes the center as he planned. And in the case of black d5, let's say, white can consider to trade the c4 pawn first. And after e takes on d5, e5, white pushes the pawn forward, e5. It allows white to keep more space in the middle of the board, and the position seems to be better for white. White can consider to play f4 to support the e5 pawn one more time. Knight d2 goes to f3, light square bishop goes to d3, aiming at the h7 pawn. White, in my opinion, should be better in this position. He has more space and in the future can develop some attack against the black king. Okay, in the game, black preferred to move the bishop to g6. Now, if white plays e4, d5 can give black a better bishop compared to the previous line. After c takes on d5, e takes on d5, white can again play e5, but this position is different from what we just discussed. First of all, white cannot bring his light square bishop to d3 to target the black king. Black can consider c5 followed by knight c6 play to quickly attack the d4 pawn. And g6 bishop in general looks better than bishop on b7. It's not limited. It has many options on the b1, h7 diagonal. Black should be fine in this position. So for this reason, white did not play e4. White continues development. g3 was played. The idea to bring the bishop to the long diagonal. The idea to attack the rook, and later on, white can consider to play e4. Black played knight c6, attacking the d4 pawn. White should spend a tempo to defend it. So white played e3. And next, black played a6. At first glance, looks a little bit strange. Black moves a pawn on the queen side with no good reason. But actually, black has a plan. Black can consider to play b5. To get rid of the c4 pawn. After he plays b5 and gets rid of the c4 pawn, he can more efficiently play d5, avoiding cd5 trade. Also, if black plays b5, he can open up the files on the queen side to create some pressure there. But one drawback of this continuation, it delays black's development. Black does not hurry to move the kingside pieces out, does not hurry to castle. On one hand, it can be risky to keep the king in the middle. On the other hand, so far, white does not have anything special in the middle of the board. He did not open up the center. He did not create any real threats against the black king. So black can afford to play a little bit slow in this position. And next, white played b4. Okay, b4 was played with the idea to develop the dark squared bishop. White wants to move his dark squared bishop to the long diagonal. After he played e3, this bishop is limited, and it's a very reasonable idea to move it to the long diagonal. Black played b5. It's consistent with black's previous move, but as the analysis and the game shows, it was not the best bet for black. Black just tries to be consistent. Black tries to counterplay on the queen side. After c takes on b5, a takes on b5, if white takes the pawn again, black can take the b4 pawn. A takes on b4 does not work because the rook on a1 is hanging, the a3 pawn is just pinned. For this reason, Kasparov did not play bishop takes on b5, he played bishop b2 instead. The bishop goes to the long diagonal and it protects the rook on a1. So now white is threatening to take on b5, and either knight takes on b4, bishop takes on b4 will not work well for black. Black played knight a7. Black moves the knight to the corner to protect the b5 pawn. And Kasparov, as usually, plays very vigorously. h4 was played next. Kasparov keeps track of the entire board. It's very important to see the entire board, to look at all sides of the board. So h5 is threatening to trap the black light squared bishop. And black played h6. It can be inaccuracy. h5 can be a better move. It weakens the g5 square. Potentially white can bring the knight to the g5 square. On the other hand, if black is able to play f6, it can be not a big deal for him. Another reason why black does not want to play h5, this pawn can be attacked later on. White can bring the bishop to e2. White can attack the h5 pawn using the bishop and the queen. Maybe later on he can bring more pieces, let's say knight on f4 to attack it. But anyway, it gives black more space. It allows black to keep the bishop on g6. So it's supposed to be a better move. However, black played h6, so we continue with h6. Okay, and it's a critical moment of the game. Black seems to have some bad pieces. Knight on a7 does not look good, but at the same time, he has a plan. So black wants to put the pawn to d5 to take control over the e4 square and improve his control over the c4 square. After black plays d5, he fixes the c4 square for his knight, so it's logical to assume that knight can go to this square. Let's say black plays c6 to defend the b5 pawn, and then knight c8, knight d6, or knight c8, knight b6, followed by knight c4. If black can bring his knight to c4, it can increase his pressure on the white's queen side. It can increase his pressure on the a3 pawn, on the white's dark squared bishop, and it can also allow black to improve his situation in the middle, improve his knight, and I think black can be better if he can implement this plan in his game. And to prevent it, white should be very vigorous. And at this point, Kasparov played d5, a pawn sacrifice that black probably did not expect. After e takes on d5, bishop g2, white cannot take it back easily because black plays c6, black got double pawns, but these pawns are pretty good. They can protect each other, and black can still consider knight transfer. He can still think about bringing the knight to c4. So does not look so dangerous for black. Yeah, maybe he cannot move the dark squared bishop out so easily because white is attacking the g7 pawn after he played d5. But again, at first glance, it looks pretty safe for black. Looks like black can finish his development on the king side in few moves, playing f6 and moving the bishop out. So the position at first glance looks pretty solid for him. Kasparov castled and black played f6. So far so good. as we discussed, bishop wants to go out and black should take care of the g7 pawn. And next, Kasparov played rook e1. Now it becomes more clear what is white's plan. White wants to attack the black king, white wants to open up the center, and definitely when he opens up the center, he wants to see his rook on the e-file. And black realizes he cannot normally finish his development. e4 is coming up and black cannot castle on time. In the game, bishop e7 was played and white continued with queen g4. So white, after he developed all his minor pieces and centralized the rook, wants to bring the queen into the play. It's a very logical thing to do. Queen goes to the king side with a tempo, attacking the g6 bishop. Now we can see one more time why black's h5 could be better for him. It could limit the white queen and make it less attractive for white to sacrifice a pawn in the middle of the board. Black played king f7. h5, why not? White can attack the bishop one more time. And after bishop h7, white finally plays e4. So, look at the position one more time, please. As you can see, white is completely developed, whereas black has issues with the king safety. His king definitely not safe. He has two minor pieces in the corners of the board, knight on a7 and bishop on h7. His queen is still on the initial position, rooks are not connected, whereas white paid just one pawn for it. It's, I think, was a very good deal for him. He developed everything, and after he plays e4, he can get more open files in the middle of the board, he can activate the knight, and so create more pressure on the black king. After d takes on e4, Kasparov played bishop takes on e4. He wants to trade the light squared bishops in order to weaken the light squares in the front of the black king and specifically the g6 square. Bishop takes on e4, knight takes on e4, and knight c8. So black tries to improve his knight. In the case of rook e8, with the idea to bring the king to g8, I think white can do queen g6 check. I'm not sure that king g8 works well for him. Bishop takes on f6 looks promising for white. After bishop takes on f6, knight takes again with a check. If g takes, it's just illegal. The g7 pawn is pinned, whereas in the case of queen takes on f6, black loses the rook. White takes it with a check, and white ends up with extra exchange. The position should be winning for him. If black plays king f8, white can consider some forcing play with knight g5. Knight g5 looks promising. F takes on g5 leads to a checkmate in one. Queen takes on g7. Whereas in the case of h takes on g5, h6, white plays h6. White once again to checkmate in one. Queen takes on g7. G takes on h6. And rook e5. Something that black probably does not expect. White is threatening to take the pawn on h6, followed by rook takes on g5, in order to open up the long diagonal for the dark squared bishop. If black takes the rook, bishop takes on e5, and queen g7 checkmate is coming. Bishop f6, bishop takes back. And white should be winning in this position. Okay, let's go back to the game. Black played knight c8, rook ad1, absolutely correct. White wants all his pieces to participate. White brings another piece in the center, so now he has no bad pieces at all. And black played rook a7. He could consider d5 alternatively, but it weakens the e6 square, so I don't think it's safe for black to weaken this square. So he preferred rook a7. And knight takes on f6. So see, after white centralized his second rook, he is ready to break through. So knight takes on f6 works well for him. So let's see what is the point. Black played g takes on f6. In the case of bishop takes on f6, White starts with a check, queen g6, king f8, bishop takes on f6, if queen takes back, rook e8, checkmate. If g takes on f6, rook e6. So this move is possible because the d7 pawn is pinned. White is attacking the f6 pawn with two pieces now. Rook f6 is coming up and black has no good defense for this pawn. After white takes the f6 pawn, he either wins the queen or checkmates the black king. G takes on f6. Queen g6 and king f8. So white sacrificed the piece. Black has more material, but at the same time, black realizes that almost all his pieces are pretty pointless. They cannot do anything to attack white, just defensive pieces. Rook on a7, as well as the rook on h8, do not contribute into the black's play at all. But minor pieces, queen on the initial position still. So yeah, white definitely has a compensation. And white continues increasing his pressure. Kasparov's next move was bishop c1. So he could not break through playing bishop f6. Bishop takes back. If bishop f6, bishop takes back. And if by analogy to the previous line, white plays rook e6, black can take this rook. Now the queen on d8 is protected by the bishop. So white wins the queen, but black gets a lot of pieces for the queen. I don't think it's what white wants to do in this position. So let's continue the game. Bishop c1. Black played d5 and white's next move was rook d4. So white is going to bring the rook to the king side. Specifically, he wants to bring it to the g file to prepare queen g7. White does not hurry to take the pawn on h6. Threat can be stronger than its immediate execution. And yeah, more pieces can do more threats, more attacks. So black is paralyzed. Black still does not have any counterplay. So white can afford to play not decisively. Black played knight d6 and rook g4. Knight f7. Black seems to be just on time to protect the pawn on h6. However, bishop h6 works. And if rook takes on h6, black gets a checkmate in one. Queen g8, checkmate in one. Knight takes on h6, queen g7 check. White starts with this check to push the black king to e8, then he takes the rook, then he can take the knight on h6. White seems to be just winning. Black played king e8, and after bishop g7, he just resigned. So the rook on h8 is hanging. If black plays rook g8, white can just push the h pawn, h6, h7. Black is still paralyzed. Black still has nothing to do. His extra piece is completely pointless in this position. So white won. So let's go back to the moment when white played d5 to emphasize it one more time. One more important thing to remember when you play your games. Always try to expect what your opponent is going to do. Try to take into consideration his plans. Remember that if you want to attack, you have to be vigorous. Don't hesitate to sacrifice, especially if it is just the beginning of the game and your sacrifice is just a pawn. If you can see a clear way to attack his king, if you can see a clear way to delay his development, just do it. Initiative is much more important thing in chess, and at the same time, don't hurry to get a material back. Remember that creating more threats can be much more important than taking material back. It was Nadezhda Kosintseva for chesslectures.com. Thank you for watching.